So, what is this limit? We need to check it out. What is the limit? We need to check it out. Okay. Consequently, so he's saying that ultimately the current will increase. First of all, the current will increase, but beyond a point, beyond one load resistance point, what happens is the current will also decrease. That is what he's saying. Okay. Any increase of the load resistance beyond this point, instead of increasing the current, ultimately results in reduced current. That's what he's saying. Even if the load resistance is going on to decrease beyond certain limit, what happens is the resistance, even if the resistance is decreasing, the current will decrease. The current will decrease. Instead of increasing, the current will decrease. That's what he's saying. Consequently, the external characteristic turns back like dotted curve as shown in the figure. So what happens because of this particular situation, what is happening is, here if you see the external characteristics in this figure 3.10, you can see the external characteristics of the shunt machine. Because of this nature of the current to decrease, even if the resistance is being decreased, because of this nature, the total external characteristic will come into a curve that is dotted, that is like this. Okay, here you can see that the curve is coming inside into the this one. Actually, what should happen? Right, actually, what should happen? Like this should be decreasing, right? It should decrease like this. This curve should be decreasing like this. But because the current is also decreasing rather than increasing, what happened here? This curve is turned like this. The curve is turned like this. Okay, so because of that, this external characteristic is a curve rather than a decreasing curve, rather than a bell half, second half of the bell curve, it is like decreasing into it. That is why we are getting something like this, like a inverted C shape. Okay, the tangent OA to the curve represents the minimum external resistance required to excite the shunt generator on load and is called as the critical external resistance. That is what we are seeing. If you draw this tangent to this curve, this OA line represents the minimum external resistance that need to be there for the voltage buildup. That is what he's saying. Okay, if the resistance of the external circuit is less than the critical external resistance represented by the tangent OA, the machine will refuse to excite and will de-excite if already running. That is what we were saying. This is the minimum resistance that the external circuit has to have, at which this voltage buildup and everything happens. If you do not have this much of external resistance, then what happens means then you can the machine will not excite. If rather than exciting, the machine will de-excite. Okay, the machine will de-excite. This means the external resistance is so low as virtually to short circuit the machine, and so doing away with its excitation. That's what we were saying. No, because if the external resistance is not present at all, then it is like the terminals are being short circuited. That is, there is nothing between those two terminals. We are just connecting those two terminals. That means the machine will go will be there is a what do you say? There is a chance that the machine will fail. Okay, there are two critical resistances for a shunt generator. First one is the critical field resistance. The second one is the critical external resistance. For the shunt generator to build up voltage, the former should not be exceeded and the latter should not be gone below. So basically, for any machine, we know that there is a certain thing called as the critical field resistance, beyond which if the machine goes, then what happens? The machine will stop building up. The voltage buildup will stop. So That is why we need to make sure that our resistance is like below the critical field resistance, right? The field resistance should be below the critical field resistance. This is what we know, right? In the same manner, there is another thing for this particular machine, which is the shunt machine. We have critical external resistance also. So the critical external resistance below which we should not go, right? Below which we should not go. The critical field resistance above which we should not go, that is, it should not be exceeded. Rather, this critical external resistance should not be gone below, that we should not reduce the external resistance below this critical external resistance. So, for a shunt machine, we have two types of limits. Those limits are critical field resistance as well as the critical external resistance. Okay. Let's go to the next topic. Next topic is nothing but the compound generator and its characteristics. In the same manner as we have seen for the series and shunt generators, we are going to see the characteristics of the compound generator as well. Here, we know that the compound generator is nothing but a combination of series and shunt generators, right? So, there is a series excitation as well as there is a shunt excitation, right? We have something which is parallel as well as which is in series with the armature. So now there are two types of compound generators, right? We have already seen this. There are two types of compound generators, which is the short shunt connection and as well as the long shunt connection. Here, if you see what is the short shunt connection, what is the long shunt connection means, if the series field and the armature is parallel to the shunt field, then it is called as a long shunt connection. Long shunt connection, that is, the series and the short, both these two are parallel to the shunt connection, then it is called as a long shunt connection. Whereas if only the armature is parallel to the Whereas of only the armature, only armature, this connection, that is S connection. If only armature is connected parallel to the shunt field, then it is called as a short shunt connection. If the connection is here, then it is called as the long shunt connection. Long shunt connection, this will be calling it as short shunt connection. Okay, long shunt and short shunt. So, this we have already known. Right, next. The compound generator can be called as the cumulatively compounded or differentially compounded generator. So the compound generator has two types of connections. First thing is you should understand whether it is a short shunt connection or a long shunt connection, that we need to know. Okay. Now after knowing whether it is a short shunt or long shunt, we need to go for next type of differentiation, which is nothing but compounded or a differential. Okay, so cumulatively compounded generator, what will happen in this cumulatively compound generator means, in this cumulatively compounded generator, the shunt field resistance, the shunt field and the series field are added. That is, the series field is aiding the shunt field. How will it be means, I'll just show you. If let us say the shunt field is in this direction. If the field is in this direction, and also the flux that is being produced by the series field is also in the same direction, then we call it as the cumulatively compounded machine. If it is in the opposite direction, that is, if the shunt field is in this direction, but the series field is opposite to this, the series field is opposite to the shunt field, then we call this as the differentially compounded. So we have two types of compoundings. The first one is the cumulatively compounding as well as the differentially compounding. But differentially compounded generators are very rarely used in practice. That is, in general sense, we do not see many differentially compounded generators. Therefore, what we are going to do is we are going to discuss only the cumulatively compounded generators. Now, it may be noted that the external characteristics of the long and short shunt compound generators are almost identical. So, what first thing we need to know is we have two types of machines, that is the long shunt machine as well as the short shunt machine. And now, in this long shunt machine and short shunt machine also, we have this again cumulatively compounded as well as differentially compounded machines. And we need to understand that the external characteristics of the long shunt and the short shunt machines are almost identical. Okay. Now, and the differentially compounded generators are rarely used. So if you just look at this diagram here, you can see load current as well as the terminal voltage. So that is, we are seeing the external characteristics of the here we are seeing the external characteristics of this machine, and you can see that there are three types of compoundings, that is the under compounded, flat compounded as well as the over compounded cases. Okay, there are three cases, that is the under compounded case, which is flat, next is the flat compounded case, and this next is over compounded case. Just a minute. Okay, here the external characteristics are being shown in this figure 3.14, and then you can see the external characteristics of a cumulatively compounded generator. External characteristics of a cumulatively compounded generator. Now here, because this is a cumulatively compounded generator, the series excitation aids the shunt excitation, that is what we are seeing. And the degree of compounding depends upon the increase in the series excitation with the increase in the load current. So how much the series excitation is being increased with the increase in the load current, that will decide what is the degree of compounding. That is, how much is the aiding going on, that will be dependent on how much of the current that is being given to the load, and how much of the excitation is changing because of the increased load current. So if the series winding turns are so adjusted that with the increase in the load current the terminal voltage increases, it is called as the over compounded generator. In such cases, as the load current increases, the series field MMF increases and tends to increase the flux and hence the generated voltage. The increase in the generated voltage is greater than the IARA drop. So that instead of decreasing, the terminal voltage increases as shown in this curve. So what will happen in this different type of over compounding, flat compounding and under compounding? This compounding depends upon the series field nature when the load current is increasing or decreasing. Okay, so if the load current is increasing beyond a point, and then because of the increased load current, the terminal voltage is also increasing, then the series winding is adjusted such that this increase in the load current increases the terminal voltage, then that type of machine is called as an over compounded generator. So what happens in this case means as the load current increases, the series field MMF also increases and tends to increase the flux. That is, if the MMF increases, then flux increases, right? So that the generated voltage will increase. Okay, so if the flux is increasing, that means the generated voltage is also increasing, right? This increase in the generated voltage is greater than the IARA drop. That is, whatever the loss is happening in the machine, that is being superseded with this increase in the terminal voltage. It is being superseded with this increase in the terminal voltage. So that is how this type of over-compounded machine happens. So if it is being superseded the IARA drop, then the terminal voltage will increase instead of decreasing, right? The terminal voltage will also increase instead of decreasing, because the, whatever the loss is there, that is being superseded. That's why this type of machine will have this this type of characteristics, that is the overcomponent characteristics. Next is, if the series next is the flat component, right? We'll see what is the flat component. Okay, if the series winding turns are so adjusted that with the increase in the load current, the terminal voltage substantially remains constant, it is called as the flat compounded generator. So in the over compounded generator, what happens as the load current increases, then the terminal voltage will also increase. The load current increases, the terminal voltage will also increase, and that increase in the terminal voltage will also be in such a way that whatever the IRA drop is there, that is being superseded and the voltage will is increasing. Okay. Now, while coming to the flat compounded generator, here the terminal voltage will remain constant even if the load current increases, the terminal voltage remain constant. That is why it is called as a flat compounded generator. The series winding of such a machine has less number of turns than one in the over compounded machine, and therefore does not increase the flux as much for a given load current. Consequently, the full load voltage is nearly equal to the no load voltage as indicated by the curve B. Here if you see, the full load voltage as well as the no load voltage are almost similar. That is flat component. That is, the terminal voltage is not going beyond the no load voltage. Okay. That is how this flat component machine will be present. Okay. If the series field winding has lesser number of turns than for a flat component machine, the terminal voltage falls with increase in the load current as indicated in the curve. So basically, this all things are depending upon the series winding. Okay, so if the series winding is in such a way that the increase in the load current increases the terminal voltage, then we are calling it as the over compounded machine. If the series field winding is not decreasing the terminal voltage, but it is maintaining a constant terminal voltage even if the full load condition, then we are calling it as a flat compounded machine. If the terminal voltage is going below the normal voltage, that is the no load voltage, then we are calling it as the under compounded machine. Okay, so the series field winding will play a very important role in determining whether the machine is over compounded, flat compounded, or under compounded. Okay, this is the different type of characteristics and different types of connections in this compound generator, and their how the nature of the characteristics is there. All these things are being discussed. Next is last topic of this chapter is applications of the compound generators. What are the different applications of the compounded generator? In some application, voltage fluctuations are accepted, but in some it is not tolerated, especially in lighting systems. If the generator terminal voltage changes, then the lights start to fluctuate. This is not accepted. So you can see here that the voltage, if the voltage, we know that if the voltage is changing, then the light will also change. That the light that is being coming from the our tube light and everything will also change, as we are seeing in this slide, which is happening. That is, the light which we experience will also be fluctuated. To eliminate these types of fluctuations, we use compounded generators. Okay, why do we use compounded generators? Means to eliminate these type of fluctuations. As the load current increases, the generator terminal voltage rises below the no load voltage. So if this happen, what we are going to do is we are going to maintain such that this IARA drop and the IR drop between the generator and load, those two things should be compensated because of the external voltage. But what if you are taking an over compounded generator, let us say if you are having an over compounded generator, then what happens, the generator terminal voltage is like greater than the no load voltage. That means even if there is a voltage fluctuation, that can be adjusted because of this extra voltage which we are getting, right? That in that application we'll be using these compounded generators. Okay, so this concludes your first chapter of this subject. Now let's go for the next topic, that is the second chapter. We are going to start the second chapter of your syllabus. Okay. So the second chapter which we are going to learn in this particular subject is the DC motors. Till now we have seen the DC generators, that is the generator is nothing but a machine which will be taking mechanical energy and converting it into electrical energy in the magnetic medium, that's by using the magnetic medium, that is the generator. We have seen different types of generators and how these generators are being excited and what are the different characteristics of these generators and how are these being, you know, constructed and all those things that we have seen till now. Now we are going to see the DC motors. We have already seen that in the starting of this subject itself, we have understood that a machine can be either run as a generator or a motor, right? A machine can be run either as a generator or a motor depending upon different parameters. So for the construction part and for all those parts, the DC machines, whatever we have learned in the DC generator will stand hold, will stand good for the DC motors as well. Okay, for the DC motors as well. So basically what we are going to see is how these DC, how many types of DC motors are there and what is the principle of operation of these DC motors and what are the different characteristics which we need to check in when the machine is being run as a motor. All those things we need to see. Okay, so let us start. DC motors. DC motors are seldom used in ordinary applications because all electric supply companies furnish alternating current. So basically DC motors do not, we do not use DC motors in large number of application because whatever the current or the voltage that is being provided for us is an AC type, right? We are DC type, what do you say, power is not being produced or it is not being supplied to us, right? So whatever we are going to see, these DC motors are rarely used. We generally don't use it in household applications. However, for special applications such as in steel mills, mines and electric trains, it is advantageous to convert alternating current into direct current in order to use DC motors. So for some special applications, so we may ask what is the use of learning about the DC motors if we are not using it in a practical way, right? So for that we have for this type of DC motors or DC machines, we have a separate application. So we have some special applications like in case of steel mills as well as electric trains and mines. All these things, they in all these things we use DC motors. So we need to understand what are the DC motors and what are the different types of things which we need to understand. The reason is that speed but torque characteristics of DC motors are much more superior than that of AC motors. Why are we using these DC motors in these different applications, these special applications? Means the speed characteristics, we'll see what are speed characteristics and all those things in the later classes, but we need to understand what is the main thing we need to keep in mind is these speed characteristics of the DC machines are much more superior to the AC, their AC counterparts. Okay, therefore it is not surprising to note that for industrial drives, DC motors are as popular as the three-phase induction motors. Okay, so these DC, because of these speed characteristics and all these things, the for any industrial applications, DC machines are as popular as the AC machines. That is what we need to understand. Okay, like DC generators, DC motors are also having three types. These are also divided into three types, that is the series wound, shunt wound and compound wound. Same thing what we have seen in the DC generators. The use of a particular motor depends upon the mechanical load it has to drive. So what type of motor we are going to use in what application will be dependent on different types of loads which we have and how much mechanical load is there and all those things will based upon all those things we need to decide which motor will be used. Okay, now let us see what is the DC motor principle. What is the principle of operation of the DC motor? DC motor principle. Its operation is based on the principle that when a current carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field, the conductor experiences a mechanical force. Okay, the direction of this force is given by the Fleming's left-hand rule, and the magnitude is given by this formula, that is F is equals to BIL. These things we already know, right? These are the basic laws of the electromagnetic induction and all those things. In that, we have seen that if we are having a current-carrying conductor in a magnetic field, if we are placing a current-carrying conductor in a magnetic field, then it experiences a force. Mechanical force. That mechanical force is given by this formula F is equals to BIL newtons, where B is nothing but the strength of this magnetic field, I is the magnitude of the current that is being carried by the conductor, L is the effective length of the conductor, which we know, right? Basically, there is no constructional difference between a DC motor and a DC generator. The same DC machine can be run as a generator or a motor. This also we know. And we know that the DC motor runs on the principle of Fleming's left-hand rule, right? We know that electromagnetic induction plays an important role, as well as the direction in which the motor is going to rotate is given by the Fleming's left-hand rule. This we know, right? A motor is nothing but a machine which converts electrical energy into mechanical energy in a magnetic medium. This we know, right? Next is Fleming's left-hand rule. This also we have already seen. The direction of the motion of the conductor in a magnetic field is given by the Fleming's left-hand rule. This we know, right? When the forefinger, thumb and the central finger of the left hand are stretched perpendicular to each other, then the forefinger represents the direction of the magnetic flux. If the forefinger represents the direction of the magnetic flux, the central finger represents the direction of the current, then the thumb represents the direction of the motion of the conductor. We have already seen this. Next is working of a DC motor. Consider a part of a multipolar DC motor as shown in the figure 4.1. What we are going to see is we are saying that the DC motor has different number of poles rather than a couple of poles. We have different many poles, that is many poled machine we are taking. Okay, rather than going into the thick and thin of these things, we will stop here. Let's stop here. Okay, we'll continue the topic in the next class. For the time being, so the first chapter is completed and we have started the second chapter.